This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
What's happening, friends? Welcome to Podcast Unlocked, IGN's weekly Xbox show, this one for April 12th, 2023. I'm Ryan McCaffrey, and I'm glad to be back, I should say. Hopefully it's good to have me back, but I'm glad to be back, and I am joined, as always, to my immediate left, Stella Chung. How are you?
Good. Hearing you say, what's happening, friends? I was like, you know what? I was right on the money with my, I started all the podcasts trying to pretend to...
Nice.
So I was right on the money.
Well done. Yeah, well done. I am nothing if not predictable, but which is, you know, can be good and bad, I guess. If it's like comfort food for a podcast. Yeah. Like, oh, I like hearing the same thing. Miranda Sanchez at the end of the other end of the table. Good to see you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm busy, but you know, making it through. Good to see you. And you are, yes, welcome back.
Thank you.
Happy to have you back.
Yeah, it was a nice little spring break. Happened to just missed two shows because we were Wednesday to Wednesday because the airfare was way cheaper that way. So thank you both for holding down the fort while I was gone. I know Brian Altano was in here talking Resident Evil, and then it was the all ladies show last week, which I love to see. But this week you're gonna have to tolerate me and my opinions again.
I guess we can.
if you don't mind. I want to start, Miranda. I'm sure you mentioned it last week as things were kicking off. We have our IGN first game for the month of April, and it is Redfall.
Yes.
The upcoming, of course, vampire first-person shooter. I'm super proud of the coverage that you've been putting out. We've had some gameplay. We've had some character trailers, character profiles, getting to know the four heroes that you can choose to play as in this.
Some of the bigger pieces are coming out a little bit toward the end of the month, so that's what is making me tired lately, but in a good way, but also news.
That said, it hasn't been the best week for Redfall in terms of... I don't know how you expect this to go. Like, there has to be the decision made as to, like, all right, well, when do we break this little bit of bad news to the community? And you know, they've chosen to do it about 3 weeks before launch, which my guess would be that's because that's when they knew for sure that they weren't going to be able to make this happen for launch. And that is a 60 frames per second option on the Series X. So on Series X, it will ship only with a quality mode, 30 frames per second in 4K on the Series X. 30 frames, 1440p on the Series S. They will add a 60 frames per second performance mode later, but we don't know when later is yet. Stella, you are, of course, our resident first-person shooter expert. You play a ton of PvP games. Mm-hmm. In a PvE experience, is the lack of 60 frames as big of a deal?
Yes.
Yes.
It's awful. I mean, okay, it's not awful, but like also thinking of this at like, you know, the 30 FPS in 4K, okay, that's nice, but how many people have 4K monitors? And also how many people really want to play in 4K when they could potentially get 60 FPS on a console that they put so much money into? Also, all of the footage that we saw in the trailers and gameplay and stuff, they were all 60 FPS and they looked great, you know?
And I think, Miranda, that's what's part of really been exacerbating this little bad PR moment for Arkane on this is exactly that, right?
And everything we've gone hands-on on with so far has been in 60 frames because it's always a PC build, right?
Exactly.
Like, that's almost always what you're going to play in any sort of preview environment unless it's like a specific console game. That's just, it's disappointing to say the least.
Yeah, I mean, I know it's a PvE experience, but still, if you're going to be showing such good gameplay and such good movement specifically, you definitely want at least 60 FPS in any sort of first-person shooter game, especially something that looks as good as this. I mean, I'm pretty sure I played Deathloop on PC and it felt really good. I got at least 60 FPS. And yeah, I definitely would not have liked that experience on 30. So my heart goes out to all of you on Xbox. I'm very sorry.
Yeah, I think the disappointment here too, right, is like one of the reasons you have consoles is you don't have to mess with the PC settings.
Yeah.
Like honestly, it's fine until it's not fine, right? Like there's so many little intricacies. They're really expensive. And so when I get a console, I don't want to have to think about those problems with settings. And if it's, you know, this is it's 2023. Like, we have these next-gen consoles. We're firmly in the cycle. And to have, like, a big Xbox game come out this year and not having 60 for a shooter at launch is really disappointing.
Two more things that add a little understandable disappointment to this for the community is, number one, this game, I think it's fair to say, was delayed for a year. The first time when they announced it, they said, it's out summer 2022. And now here it is, it's out in spring 2023, so nearly a year. So there's that piece of it. And also, it's a bad look. This is a major first-party release from Xbox, and Xbox has been touting the Series X as the most powerful console, and here we go with 30 frames. This, I know, I'm probably going to get chewed up in the comments for this, but, like, I can't help from having studied and covered and watched this industry for so many years. I don't know if either one of you agree with me or disagree with me, but I feel like this wouldn't happen on PlayStation. Like, this just one way or another. Now, granted, I guess there wouldn't even be a PC version to, so there's that side of it. But yeah. I just feel like this is another one of these. Now, it's not the worst thing in the world. The game still is going to come out on May 2nd. It's hopefully going to be really fun. We've all played it. We've enjoyed what we've played so far. But I just feel like it's another one of these little step on the rake moments for Microsoft that they can't seem to get out of their own way of.
Yeah, I will say every game that I've booted up on the PS5, I've always seen the option for performance or quality, and that's been really great. And you brought this up to us, you know, like, as a discussion before the show, and I was like, you know what? Yeah, you're right. I don't think I've ever seen a game on the PS5 where, like, I couldn't choose between the two. There were always the two options. So the first exclusive from Xbox not having this is, especially an FPS title, it's kind of a big deal. And everyone has been, this was delayed, obviously, for good reasons, but, like, everyone was looking forward to this. This was going to be like aside from Minecraft Legends, this was going to be the big thing that, like, really set forward the Xbox exclusive launches this year. And it's a rocky start.
Yeah. Well, of course, shout out to our friends at Tango Gameworks. They really got the year off on a great foot, to be fair on that. But in fact, speaking of Tango Gameworks, right on schedule, Ghostwire Tokyo, the last game they did, which of course was had a year of timed exclusivity on PS5, that is now available on Xbox on Game Pass, along with a new content update. So if you haven't had a chance to play that yet for whatever reason, it's right there on Game Pass for you too. So another first party game, albeit a rare case of one that's been on another console for the last year, but that doesn't take away from the fact that Ghostwire Tokyo's a good game. I mean,
fine.
Yeah, admittedly not on the level of
Hi-Fi Rush.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah. I've been on vacation for 2 weeks and the name was just like, where is it? It's in here somewhere.
I will say I kept getting Hi-Fi Rush and High on Life mixed up because the pacing of the words
my brain, the only thing that was in my brain was Sunset Overdrive. Like, it's not Sunset Overdrive. So thank you, Miranda, for having my back as I try to get back into the flow of podcasting. I'm a little rusty, as you can see. So yeah, give that a go if you have not played it on Game Pass. And then let's have a little more good news here, because actually we're going back to bad news after this. So we're having a good news break right now.
Pacing it.
Yeah.
Miranda, your preview of Minecraft Legends went up, I think, shortly after last week's podcast, right? You would not have.
We didn't get to talk about it.
So I want to turn the floor over to you here. As Stella noted, this is the next official first party release. It's what? Is that out in about a week or two? It's this month. It's coming up very soon.
No, not 28. That's Jedi Fallen. Oh my God.
It's soon. It's very soon. It's before Redfall. It's sometime in April.
It's April 18th.
Thank you. So that's actually,
it's just after my birthday.
Okay. So it's next Tuesday, of course.
Dead Island, April 21st.
Yeah, coming right up. So
Jedi Fallen Order 28th.
Yes.
that's what I'm holding out for.
I know.
Yeah. I can't wait. I've had the pleasure of playing about 5 hours of it, and my spidey sense tells me it's going to be excellent. So, we shall see very soon. But Minecraft Legends, Miranda, You were optimistic on this game from the jump, from when we first had it in the well, I guess in a showcase, and then more recently in the Developer Direct in January. Actually playing it, how'd it go?
It's so immensely charming. I think when I first sat down to start playing, the music was just right. The characters that they introduce are so funny and kind, and it's just... You know, sometimes when you play a game or something, they're like, you know what? We believe in you and we're proud of you and we're excited to have you here. It was just that kind of welcoming sense that almost sounds like it could be really cheesy, but it felt so genuine that when I got started on this adventure, it felt like, and I read this in my preview, that I was being rewarded for my time in Minecraft. It's like, you've done some cool stuff. Now we trust you to do this really cool thing for us. And the thing that I loved most about this was... just the genuine sense of accomplishment every time I did something, even if it was easy. Like, everyone gets really excited that you took down that early base. So I only played about an hour of this, and this campaign's around, like, I think 15 to 20 hours or something. So it gets pretty long. And even with what I had discovered early on, it felt pretty good on controller. And I specifically wanted to play on controller because I think with strategy games like this, it makes a lot more sense on PC. Mouse and keyboard, more options for commands and all that good things too. And I definitely struggled a little bit with controls at first because it's a lot of things to remember, but they do a good job of like peppering in new things to learn, new commands, like send this specific units here, send these here. This is like action strategy, so it is not meant to be too heavy on like all the commands, but the ones that I had were really cool. Overall, I'm really excited to play this. The only downside I had really was multiplayer. So that's the one that I was actually rather excited for, and I think it's kind of reverse where I'm more excited about the campaign adventure. Multiplayer is PvPvE. So what it is you get two teams of four, and your objective is to go destroy the other base. And so in that, like, you want somebody building, you want people resource collecting, you want to keep like building up to get new upgrades. And just like in Minecraft, you start from zero. So every game you start from zero. And if your team is not coordinated, or if they're not communicating, which communication is just through pings, basically, or if you can hop onto a voice chat or something, that's it. And so it's kind, like I said, it was sort of a safety thing, which I get that, but also not having more direct, like maybe like chat wheel or something that's more available, or like a way to declare roles of like, I want to build, or I want to resource collect, I want to fight, like there's a, or I'm going to go explore. You kind of lose that coordination. And like, I had a team of three other people with me on my row. The other team we were fighting had one developer on their team. And I was like, listen, that's rude. And then, so me and two,
a ringer.
Me and two of the guys were like kind of just yelling at each other because we didn't have comms on our headsets. And so, and then the fourth guy, I have no idea what he was doing. He could have just not been there for all I know. And so it was just really hard to coordinate. And we ended up playing for like 40 minutes in this
one round.
One round, which they said it should go for like 20. It's like, well, here we are. But I think it's just because one of the guys on my team just did a really great job base building. But with that all being said, I don't know if I'd want to play it with random people. Just because of that, because it feels like if it's going to be a time investment, and if I can't coordinate with you on like objectives, or hey, maybe we should put a door here so I can get through the wall because you keep blocking everything off and I can't get through without destroying your wall every single time, which was a thing, then, you know, like there's a lot of little things that can happen. So overall though, it's super cute. I'm really excited for it. If you have friends that want to play multiplayer with you, I'd say do it. You guys will rule. I think
I'm glad to hear that this is like a real thing and not just like, oh, it's a little, you know, lower quality side thing. Like, no, it's a real proper, fully featured, sounds like mostly very good Minecraft game.
Like Minecraft story mode from Telltale was fine. Like, it's always hard to put stories to Minecraft because so much about it is like your own imagination, your creativity, you and your friends doing something together. And so with this, it does still feel loose enough to where there is a story, but you're still at the center and you kind of get your own space for headcanon. So that's what I liked about it.
And then, of course, we had Minecraft Dungeons, which is also a good game that's continued to do well over time. So the Minecraft family... getting bigger here in just another week.
And since then,
snuck right up on us.
Gotten back into Minecraft. So.
All right. I promise we're going back to bad news, unfortunately. So let's just do that. In fact, let's see. Well, then we'll see how much time we have, because then things get weird again in the news. So we'll see if we make it that far. But this Friday afternoon, a little birdie whispered to me. Oh, did you hear that Joseph Staten not only had left 343 to go back to Microsoft Publishing, but he actually left Microsoft. I'm like, oh. And I got in touch with one of our ace reporters, Rebecca Valentine, and she was able to get confirmation from Microsoft. So that was sort of a weird little unexpected news scoop for us right on the end of the day on Friday. And I reached out to Joe, sent him a private note, and then he took to Twitter to comment on our story as well. But yeah, Joseph is leaving Microsoft altogether. So obviously, in the big shakeup at 343 that we had fairly recently, amidst all a lot of the layoffs at Microsoft as a whole, and 343 was definitely affected by that. Joseph had gone back to his role at Microsoft Publishing, and in fact, as I think of it now. So I had done an unfiltered interview with him when, Miranda, you and I went up to do our IGN first on Halo Infinite, which would have been we were there in October of 2021, because then the content rolled out in November. And I had asked him that question. I said, well, are you going to stick around? Or are you going to go back to publishing? And I think he gave me a pretty, I'm not quite sure yet what I'm going to do, which I take him at face value for. I'm sure he maybe hadn't made that decision yet. He was just trying to get Infinite to the finish line. But Microsoft confirming to IGN saying, we're grateful for Joseph's contributions to the Halo franchise and Xbox as a whole. We wish him all the best in his new adventure. And then Joe himself, again, taking to Twitter to comment on our report saying, hey folks, I am indeed leaving Microsoft. I'll have more info to share soon, but for now, I'd just like to thank all my Xbox colleagues for all their understanding and support as I embark on a new adventure. Now, if you're a newer Halo fan or younger fan, just a quick reminder that Joseph Staten wasn't just the guy that helped land the Halo Infinite plane as they constructed it in midair as they were trying to land the thing. Joseph, of course, was an OG Bungie guy who wrote all of the original Halo games. He also directed Halo 3 ODST, which is beloved by many. In fact, it's a lot of Halo fans' favorite Halo thing, because it's really a unique take on Halo. But so, of course, Halo 1, Halo 2, Halo 3, ODST, and then he was the original lead writer on Destiny before he left Bungie and went to Microsoft to join in the publishing space, where he kind of helped with stuff like ReCore and I'm trying to think. There might have been one or two other. Crackdown 3, I think he did some writing on and helped out as far as that one was getting to the finish line.
On his LinkedIn, it says, ship's titles include ReCore, State of Decay 2, Fight Simulator, Tell Me Why, As Dust Falls, as well as multiple announced games such as Fable and Contraband. Oh. Another announced title still in development. So, senior creative director just helping out with publishing.
Yeah, so, this is another, it's, I wish him well. Let me just, this has nothing to do, what I'm, everything I'm about to say has nothing to do with Joseph. I mean, I did title this episode in a certain way, and I will get to that in a moment, because that is expressing gratitude to him for all the insane amount of entertainment that he has had a large hand in providing. But I think this does further call into question the already, for the time being, murky future of Halo. I think that is fair to say. Now, I know him leaving Microsoft altogether is maybe not really much different in the direct Halo sense as him leaving 343 to go back to Microsoft Publishing, but like there is now, he will not be contributing in any way to Halo moving forward, barring some...
As far as we know, yeah.
Yeah, we'll bring you on as a consultant or whatever. He will not have any sort of I don't want to say meaningful, but like large hand in whatever comes next with Halo. So
he could be, though, a farmhand, which if you look at his LinkedIn, he was a farmhand from March 1997 to March 1998. Worked a year at his family
at his winery.
Yeah,
yeah. We talked about that in the Unfiltered.
Yeah,
yeah.
Wow.
And maybe he does. Maybe he's got some Bungie bucks under the mattress from. I mean, well, here's the thing. So, Bungie, they have like corporate internal stock, and Joseph, having been there a long time, if he hung on to that after he left, and then Sony buys Bungie for $3 billion, maybe he will just go back to the winery, and hey, if he does that, he's earned it. Good for him. All the best. But let's talk about first where are we with 343 and Halo now, and where's our optimism level here? I'll start with Stella.
This is funny because I just started playing through Halo Infinite, the campaign, with my friend because we were running through all the past campaigns. It's multiplayer. I mean, we didn't actually play multiplayer, but we just did the campaign. It was fine. Some connection issues. And I was like, all right, this is good. I mean, I'm able to actually experience the campaign the way I wanted to now, you know, a while after launch. So that's good. But I don't know. I feel like my friend went back to play multiplayer. I know Miranda's gone back to play multiplayer and has said that it's fine. It's better. But for me, it's not enough for me to want to come back. So I feel like the current trajectory has been kind of just stagnant. I think that's
okay. That's fair.
Yeah. So I feel like Joseph leaving isn't really going to affect much because I feel like he already hadn't affected much
recently.
No, yeah, like, recently. Not like
obviously
in the past.
Shipping the game and
yeah, of course. I just mean like obviously, you know, you said that he left 343 before, and then now he's left Microsoft. I feel like the new team is pretty good at handling things. They brought more people on who know live service, so they might be able to make improvements. And it's so interesting because I do see the community kind of split on, well, we want people who are seasoned and know a lot about Halo to work on this. But then other people are like, no, let's bring in some fresh new eyes because clearly we need like a refresh. We want to know, you know, what other people can do with this franchise. So it's a weird like balance. I think I'm leaning more towards like the newer part because for me, I'm a new Halo fan and I'm just like, you know, it'd be really cool if you could do something to kind of like wrap up the previous stories or like I was talking to my friend about the campaign. He was like, well, yeah, this was kind of like a soft reboot. Like they're setting up the future of Halo, you know, especially with the weapon turning into Cortana, like a new version of Cortana that we can be emotionally attached to. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, no, that makes sense. So I'm still hopeful for future games, and I really wouldn't mind bringing in, you know, newer people to the franchise to like help build that future.
Yeah,
so that's kind of where I'm at.
Miranda, this is I think you and I saw, I mean, we all saw Halo Infinite before Joseph came on, that disastrous 2020 showcase demonstration.
I'm literally looking at Craig right now.
Yeah. which was, by all accounts, seemingly the catalyst for bringing Joseph on to say, hey, we need some help here. Who better than you? And you know, I think we got to give Joe Staten some flowers. I mean, not that he did it all by himself,
right,
but like Infinite needed a strong direction to get it from where it was in 2020 when it was supposed to ship in mere months to where it actually ended up at shipping, where I gave the campaign a 9 and I stand by that. I think it is an outstanding campaign. And that was really, and you know, Joseph had to make those tough calls, which obviously not everybody's going to be happy when it's okay, we have to cut split screen and because of our time and resource situation. But you know, I think he did a great job, and from what we saw of the game before he came in to the game we got, Miranda.
Right, absolutely. And I think ultimately Halo Infinite for me is remembered as a really great time. Like I in fact missed the campaign, and it's been a while since I've been able to go back and play that in co-op or something. But I've liked the multiplayer well enough right now. Like, they're doing a Fracture event, so it's in week two of that. So they're still maintaining things. There's some things of interest, like the new maps that they introduced were pretty fun. I like how they're integrating community maps in that playlist, that if you do want something refreshed, you have an option. Although, of course, it is a community creation, so the balance might be a little bit different. Right. Overall, I don't think Joseph Staten leaving really impacts my feelings about 343 or Halo at this point. It's just more of a... Well, I'm mostly just curious to see what he does next. If he's going to do the trendy thing, which, I mean, I said trendy, but there's a lot of people starting new studios, right? A lot of big developers, big teams that are really iconic, their leads breaking off and doing their own thing to do something entirely new, or just to join other forces and see what they can do. So,
yeah, I think that's well said. I mean, I'd kind of already, because Joseph had already moved off of 343 and back to publishing, I'd already accepted the fact that he's not going to be at least in the director's chair for whatever the next 5 or so years of Halo looks like. And so it kind of begs the question now of, I wonder which way Microsoft is going to go with the next 4 or 5 years of Halo. Do they kind of go the id Software route, where kind of the old hands all have moved on, and they bring in, they like you were saying, Stella, it's the young generation, the new talent at the studio that has a new vision for it and can and gets an opportunity to bring it forward. Or, you know, with Infinite, Microsoft and 343 had brought in a number of really seasoned developers in lead roles, people like Joseph, people like Paul Crocker, who Miranda and I got to talk extensively with when we did visit 343. He had worked on the Rocksteady's Batman Arkham trilogy, and there were a number of folks like that. So I kind of, you know, I wonder which way they'll go. If they say, hey, let's hand this off to the kids, and I don't mean that in any kind of like derogatory way, but just like, you know, let's hand this off to the younger generation. Or do we want to bring in like, oh, this thing is, it's our huge IP. We better bring, you know, we better just write some big checks and try and sign some big free agents here and bring in some like established talent. I don't know which way they're going to go. And I'm not sure, I don't know what the right answer is for that.
Only time will tell.
Yeah, that's tough, because Halo's just been such a huge name in the games industry just for so long. It's been such a big powerhouse, so it's hard. I can't I don't know. I remember, like, in high school, people talking about Halo and like, oh my god, I can't wait to see what this brings next and stuff like that, and that's still happening. So I don't know. I mean, it's exciting, but we'll just have to see, because like, I haven't seen anything else come out about Joseph leaving after that announcement and then after Monday.
Yeah, follow-up. Probably that's about be a it. Bit till we see the follow-up of what's next.
Yeah,
I mean, it's, you know, it's being, we don't want to invade his privacy and
be like,
come on, man, tell us what you're up to.
Yeah, he's enjoying more time on the farm, you know.
But the other side of this, before I come back around to just like reflecting from a 10,000-foot view on Joseph Staten's incredible contributions to this franchise, regardless of which way Microsoft goes, trust in the kids or signing some veteran talent, I think it's safe to say we've probably seen the last of Halo from a single player campaign perspective for at least another 4 to 5 years. Like, we're going dark again for a while. It sure seems like, on the campaign front.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Which is a bummer.
I say that like in a very deflated way. Like, I say that with
Halo Infinite was going to be a platform
for the next 10 years of Halo.
Yeah, but
it turns out maybe that the next Halo is 10 years away. I hope not. Yeah. But we waited six? 2015 to 26.
Wow.
6 years between 5 and Infinite. And at least Infinite washed the bad taste of 5's campaign out of our mouths. So there's that.
I just hope the next Gears is good.
Well, you know,
I guess my random transition there is just like thinking about Microsoft studios that they have created, not acquired, and just looking at them and seeing how I feel sort of disheartened with how they've been managed and their progress generally, and except the Coalition seems to be doing okay. Obviously, 343 was sort of gutted, and then we don't know what's going on.
Turn 10's doing well.
They have
stayed right on course, which is great. And the Initiative being the other one, which is still nothing to show for themselves after quite a number of years
now.
We
knew it would be a bit, which is what happens with new studios, but it's just hearing things from that don't seem to be too promising either, which is, I think, is my big concern.
I am glad you did mention Gears real quick, Miranda, because I know I'm veering a little off course from where I just said I was going to go, but a Twitter follower and Unlock listener named Marcos Souza tweeted me, said his original question that he tweeted at me says, at this point in time, which is more important to Xbox, Halo or Gears? Is Halo really as integral of an IP as we all thought? And, you know, I couldn't help but think in my head, well, gosh, they're both kind of in a not awesome place right now. Halo's active. Season 3 is good. It is being actively supported. There is a game on the Series X. So I don't want to make it seem like, oh, Halo's just dead for another 5 years. That's not what I'm trying to say. I do think, again, campaign-wise, we're probably not going to be getting anything for quite some time. But Gears, you know, Miranda, you and I are, I think, very high on what the Coalition has accomplished with Gears 4 and Gears 5. Some people in the community don't share our opinion with that. But the flip side there is the Coalition has been pretty quiet for a while. The last thing we got was
tech demo.
Tech demo for which one? The Matrix thing?
Tech demo?
Yeah. I mean,
it's not a game, but yeah.
Right. I was going to say Hive Busters.
Yeah.
Which was 2020, I believe.
That's
so a little, you know, nice. And that was awesome, by the way. If you haven't played, it's on Game Pass. Gears, it's gorgeous. It is this absolutely gorgeous little 3-hour sort of separate mini campaign. But we have no insight on where Gears 6 is. We know it's in the works, but it hasn't officially been announced. So Miranda, kind of bums me out to think, well, gosh, I think both Halo and Gears are at the moment pretty far from their peaks. It's not to say there won't be more peaks in the future, but like if I were to think about Halo's peak, I mean, obviously it came out of the gate so strong with Halo 1, but I would argue Halo's peak was from the launch of Halo 2 in fall of 2004 through the Halo 3 years.
Yeah.
2-3, you know, and then there was, you know, ODST did well, Reach did well, 4 was really good, 5 had great multiplayer, but I would say that sort of 04 to 07, 08 window. And then Gears' peak, I would argue, probably overlapped with that, because you just had the original trilogy, 06 to 2011, Gears 1 to 3, and then, you know, Judgment kind of falls off, and from a big deal cultural community impact perspective, 4 and 5, though excellent games, have not had the same level of like, I gotta buy an Xbox for this kind of thing. So where are we, Miranda? To Marcos's question, what do you think is either more important to Xbox than the other? Are they both? Is either one even the most important thing in the Xbox portfolio right now? Because you could argue that, well, is Starfield, you know, before it's not out, but is that the most important thing right now?
Yeah, that's the thing, is Microsoft is in the business acquisitions, right? And so the most important things to them probably is their newly acquired studios. Instead of creating new IP, they bought them. And I think that's really what they're playing for here. And I think Halo is still really important because Master Chief is so iconic and associated with the Xbox. He kind of is a mascot in a way, but they've obviously had some storytelling problems here and just generally some quality things here and there. And obviously 343 as it is right now is a problem. So to shift away from that, we look at Bethesda. We look at new acquisitions coming up. We champion these other studios. We have, you know, Psychonauts with Double Fine. Like, there's a lot of things there to champion and be excited about. And I think that's kind of what they're trying to lean into, rather than just saying, these are our big things. These are our big guns, our men with big guns and big guns. But, you know, that's...
I see what you did
that's
there.
That's true. Thank you. Yes. And I think it's been nice to see Kate being championed alongside Marcus for Gears promotional things a lot. Like, you see Kate everywhere and I'm just like, hee. But that's fantastic. Though, it, as you've said, Gears just doesn't click with as many people. I'm not too sure why, because it's fantastic. But, you know.
It did in 06, yeah. In the 360 yeah. era. It's just
I
not.
I think it's the over-the-shoulder thing. I know that maybe. Definitely kept me from approaching it for a while. But then I was like, oh, no, well, it doesn't matter.
You would love Gears multiplayer if you haven't.
Oh,
really
no, I loved it. Okay, yeah, good. No, I was, yeah.
Is it not just, like, the state of shooters, like, as a core shooter game? It kind of feels like it's fallen off in a weird way, whereas like competitive multiplayer shooters are where it's at, whereas yeah. story-based shooters just don't excel in the same way as they used to. And that kind
I would
of
argue they're not being made like they used to, but that's a separate
yeah,
conversation.
But I think when we look at these big AAA worldwide franchises that everyone talks about, they're really story-driven. They're longer, more set-piece based, whereas yes, shooters have that, but not in the same way. Like, you're not going to play a 40-hour first-person shooter. I mean, I would, but those just don't happen, right? Shooter campaigns a lot shorter, they're condensed, they're very focused, and we don't see those being as, I think, lauded amongst, like, either media or just people as well in the community. So I think that's maybe something that's different there, too, whereas, like, Xbox's main IP were so heavy on first-person and third-person shooters, whereas what's really taken off are these big narrative adventures that don't necessarily lend as well. They could, but they're just not the same
right.
in that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fair. Yeah, it's...
I know, it's like a very big, like, weird, like, big brain moment.
We could do another show on this. Like,
I'm like, what?
I guess I'll say I can't wait until Gears 6 officially comes around, because A, I want to see it on Unreal Engine 5.
Yes.
It will be nothing if not gloriously beautiful.
Exactly. Like, the thing is, even if you don't play the Coalition's games, like, their games are gorgeous. Like, just look at them. Just look at them for a minute and marvel.
But also, how are they going to rectify, how are they going to deal with the choice that happens late in
I like to
in
think
Gears 5
taking so long for development? I think that's what's setting it off. But
and if you don't know what I'm talking about, go play Gears 5.
I gotta finish it. I started playing it, especially with a friend, and then we just kind of both got busy, so I gotta finish it.
Yeah, four is great if you haven't played four as well. Start, you know, you can start there. That's kind of a good, and if you haven't played any of the Gears games, Start
with one.
I mean, start with one. There's no reason not to. They're all they hold up very well. But just coming back to Halo and Joseph Staten real quick, I do wonder what he will do next. I mean, again, if he did get any piece of that Bungie sale to Sony, then he may very well be able to just walk off into the sunset and just go literally buy a plane, because he loves to fly. He's a big, like, that's his thing. He loves to fly. He has his pilot's license, and so he may just fly himself around the world and spend his remaining decades on this earth, because he's a young man just flying around from above, and I would be so happy for him. But if he does want to come back into gaming, I'd have to think he'd have a lot of suitors, be they other established development studios that would want to bring in the guy that wrote all the Halo games, the original trilogy. Or, as you said, Miranda, you know, he connects up with some friends who may also be free agents, and maybe he starts up a new thing.
Yeah, lots of people starting new things. Again, I keep saying it every time we talk about this. I'm like, I gotta start that Google sheet of all the new studios from people who split off from big studios, because there's so many. Do you think he'd go back to Bungie?
I don't know.
I don't personally know if his departure was on good terms or not. I guess there weren't any rumors of bad terms. There have been with certain longtime Bungie folks. But yeah, assuming all left off well, I don't know. I mean, I presume it wouldn't be to work on Destiny, because that's like just its total own thing now. Mm-hmm. But
they're new projects.
They do have a couple of new projects that are publicly like known about, even if they're not formally announced things. So you never know.
Do you think Staten's specialty is in like sci-fi space focused games?
That's certainly been what he's done.
Yeah.
Like that's what his resume looks like, but maybe he's wanting to stretch out and write a fantasy thing or a, I don't know, a mother style, you know, Earthbound kind of RPG that's just set in the real world.
When
you know,
you said mother, I thought the movie Mother, and I was like, wow, that'd be really intense.
Oh my god, same here. I was like, oh, okay.
Earthbound, yes.
Sorry, yeah. For some reason, the Japanese name of that series came into my brain before the Western name of the series did.
Yeah, but maybe he wants a break from all the futuristic sci-fi like burly stories. So
maybe he just wants to write about planes.
Yeah.
Maybe he just wants to fly planes like you.
Maybe
said.
He wants to write Microsoft Flight Simulator fan fiction from
Wait,
just novels. It's got to, doesn't it?
Oh my god!
I mean, he did write at least one of the Halo novels. So I'm sure if he said, "Hey, Microsoft, can I start writing Flight Simulator novels?" Just about, you know, who says no? They're not going to say no. Microsoft loves IP.
Maybe he could write about a romance novel. He could write a romance novel where two people meet flying past each other in Microsoft Flight Simulator. There's a market for that.
Yeah. And what's the, what is that called? Those little ads you put where the, like, I missed you, and it's a little description. What are those called again?
Oh, my God.
Missed connections. Thank
yes.
you.
Yeah.
Yeah, except, passed you over the sands of Egypt.
Missed connections and a missed flight.
Right.
Will they make it?
Love okay. at 30,000 feet.
Yes!
I do not see any Microsoft Flight Simulator fanfic.
How? Like... I'm surprised that nobody has gone down that road or I guess taken to those skies as of yet.
Listeners, please write Ryan a one paragraph fanfic and send it to his email so we can read it next week.
Listen, fanfiction is a great time.
Please.
Yeah. But yeah, again, like, you know, whatever Joseph's up to, I really like, I've talked to him on and off for a long time because I've been, you know, hanging around this industry for a long, long time too. And I'm so grateful to Joseph for like, he helped birth the Halo universe. Halo 1's story, of course, was so great. Halo 2's was, I mean, I'm old enough to remember, when Halo 2 came out, the story was like, people were freaking out because what? I'm now playing as the Arbiter. Like, whoa! You can't do this.
I was so
people
excited.
Were really like freaked out by that. But I remember even being a little like, I don't know if I like this Arby guy. But when I came back to it later to review the Master Chief Collection, and of course the star of that was Halo 2 Anniversary, the full, you know. Not a remake, but that just very modern coat of paint that they put over the top. And you could press a button to switch back and forth between the original and the new one. And coming back at it like 10 years later, it really, without the sort of chaos and emotions of when I first played it, when it first came out. So having some distance from it, I remember finishing it again on Halo 2 Anniversary and going, wow, this is a really great campaign. Like, the parallels are, there's so many great parallels between what Arbiter's going through and what Chief is going through. And then, of course, Halo 3, like, the dude, Staten nailed, like, he nailed the landing on that trilogy of ending it in a great way that gave closure, that gave satisfaction, that wasn't some... you know, cheap cliffhanger, even though there was, you know, at the post-credits scene, there was the little, well, you know, maybe there's something that's going to happen again eventually. But Just so grateful to Joseph ultimately, he was directly had a, I don't know if he wrote Reach, because that was Marcus Leto's thing. So I'm going to say for sure, 1, 2, 3, ODST, and Infinite. Okay. And I love all five of those Halo games. Those are all so tremendous. So just much love to Joseph Staten. And I'm so grateful that he did give me the hour or so to sit down and interview him about his whole career when we were up at 343 a year and change ago. So if you never listened to that or watched that, it's on YouTube or the Unfiltered podcast feed. You can go check that out, and it's still going to be probably a pretty relevant conversation. All right. We have already just about reached the end of the line here for this week. I'll just mention real quick, I know this pleases both of you, especially you, Miranda, the Elite Series 2 controller getting just an avalanche of new colors.
I mean, nice.
It's great, but like, I already bought mine.
I waited because I had one, but now I'm like,
it's fine.
I'm going to wait longer because what if there are cool special editions this year?
It's fine. I like mine. It's fine.
So you have now, they're available now. You now have the choice of 16 main colors, 12 face button colors, 17 accent colors for the paddles and D-pad, and 25 accent colors for the rest of the controller. You can go absolutely wild in the design studio. The new expansion starts at a price point of $149. Some of the new colors include Garnet Red, Glacier Blue, and Deep Pink, along with new options like Blackout ABXY buttons, which sounds really good. I would probably,
that's what I want.
I would probably go down that road. Microsoft is so good. I still think I will, you know, the DualSense is fine. It's so much better than the previous DualShocks. I still think the Xbox controller, the new, you know, the Series X controller is just far and away the greatest controller ever made, period. And what a nice revenue stream this must be for Microsoft too, because you get people like us buying like 2, 3, 4 different customized controllers.
Listen, Ryan, last episode, we had a nice long conversation about justifying how many controllers you could have and dedicating a controller per room, also per place. It's like, well, what if you just need it for something? I don't know. There's a lot of reasons. Also, you can style them to your own fashion sense. You can, of course, like show your fandom. And then we are talking about how a lot of listeners and just people in the community generally have like those cool controller walls and like their game rooms. Like, dang, you can do so much here.
Yeah. It's I love that they offer so many choices. And by the way, anybody, even if you live by yourself, you have full, nobody can call you out or question you if you have 4 controllers in your house, because 3 friends might come over and want to play a 4 player game.
Listen.
So if you're going above 4, then maybe you're getting more into boutique collector kind of territory, but everybody's got license to have at least 4.
Yeah, that's true. I was about to say, hey, I have more than 4. Okay. But that's when I was like, well, what if I'm in this room and I have this Xbox, but I have this older Xbox here that I need to use it for. And then I should get another for the office. You know, there's reasons.
I love that Microsoft offers this. And I think it's baffling that Sony does not do the exact same thing with the DualSense. And Nintendo with the Pro. I would buy a Mario color scheme Pro controller. I would buy that because I use the Pro controller pretty much for any Switch game I'm playing. I just prefer it because it's basically a 360 controller.
I've never owned one.
It's weird. It sucks that it's all through like third party. It's not the same. And it's so interesting because I know that with one of the third part PowerA specifically, I spoke to them about, you know, their packagings and their console controllers, and they're like, oh yeah, we don't have one for PlayStation yet. We do have a charging station, but they just haven't like allowed anyone to use their license or have any information about their controllers. And then when they did come out with their own Pro controller, and my friend was like, oh, are you buying it? I was like, no. It doesn't offer like half the things that I would want on it. What? No, absolutely not. And it has worse battery life. No, I'm good.
Yeah. Anyway, bravo Microsoft for continuing to, you guys get the game situation still needs work, but the controller situation, A+, no notes,
Living all their best good. Life. Yes. So stylish.
And with that, we've come to the end of Unlocked 590. Hopefully we'll have happier things to talk about next week. But this is what it is. We're here to keep it. Yeah, we'll keep it 100, as the kids say. Mm-hmm. We take the good with the bad, and we'll have at least next week we'll have Minecraft Legends out, and hopefully the whole thing is going to be good. What Miranda played seems like it's trending in the right direction. So we've got that. We've got Star Wars Jedi Survivor coming up as a, that's next gen exclusive. Yeah. There's no Xbox One version of that. So that's to look forward to on the Series X coming up. So, all right. I am on Twitter if you'd like to follow me, DMC_Ryan. And I don't think I have anything else to promote, so I will throw to Stella.
Sure. You can follow me everywhere at Parallax Stella. I think the most recent thing that I'm working on right now is the X Defiant First Impressions, because I only got an hour in the game. I'm not doing a preview off just an hour, especially in a multiplayer game that has so much nuance to it. So yeah, that's going to be coming out tomorrow. So keep an eye out for that.
Sounds good. Miranda, take us home.
You can follow me at Havoc Girls, and that's Havoc with a K, on Twitch, Twitter, and Instagram. And please check out our Redfall hero stories. So that has some nice exclusive details about character backgrounds along with their kits. I'll have my preview and a very cool interview coming up here soon, too. So please check those out, because they've been a lot of work.
Excellent. Yes, thank that you. Redfall IGN first coverage rolls on. Thank you to our super producer, super sneezy producer, Red. And also to Daisy the Boxer, who's secretly been right down here the whole time. She was nice and quiet today, unlike Zelina, the future service dog, who probably would have barked for attention repeatedly during this. Thank you, Daisy, for staying nice and chill. All right, we will see you all next week.